aggressive individuals and subjects who are trying to harm others.
Thank you. The gentleman over here. And then we'll go over here to you, Mark.
Hi, Michael Burley from New Hampshire Public Radio. Just a couple of questions for Chief Miola. One, you talked about outside elements. I was hoping that you could speak a little more about that as far as what impact that had. Have you heard about the company Inner Rage? And if they have any role in this at all, and if so, would they be culpable potentially criminally in this situation? And second, did the department ever consider using the Bearcat? Did it use it? And if so, was that discussion had, and why or why not?
Let me start with Bearcat first. It was staged close to the footprint. We did not envision using it. We didn't for this incident. It was no need. It wasn't that level of event. So we left it where it was. So it didn't even come into play, not even into our mind. Relative to Finnerage, and I think that's really where social media played a big role with Finnerage and how they market themselves to come and throw parties and their term is ragers or rage. So I think that initially played a part in bringing elements to Keene. That's my sense as we read the social media, as we saw some of the communications that were taking place there. And that really prompted us to work closely with students and with the landlords to let them know that if we're going to host this part, you have to do it responsibly, you have to do the parameters of common sense. So, as the landlords became aware of Finnerage in this community, they all made it fairly clear they didn't want them on their property and the parties that ensued as a result. You can tend to get out of control, as we've seen in the past. They're not saying that was Finnerage's fault in the past, they're just saying that's what occurs. So, I think they came into town to set up, and the landlord that they were going to set up became aware of it. Best of my knowledge, they did not set up and they went home. So I think the fact that the social media was already out there and were coming and inviting people perhaps brought that population here. Can't be certain of it, but that's my sense.
Over in the front row, Mark.
Hi, Martha Shannon. My first question is whether you know of any other more serious injuries that weren't included in the injuries that were treated in the field or at the hospital in Keene. And then also whether, before things got really crazy, if there was any thought of canceling the festival itself because of the possible danger to people in the festival.
Relative to the injuries, I think they're still trying to pull together all the data on that. I've been in contact with Fire Chief Howard. To the best of our knowledge, they dealt with lacerations and some head injuries. We did hear reports of burns from fireworks. We understand folks were throwing fireworks into the crowd and perhaps sustained some burns, but we have no confirmation that those were treated by the fire department or the hospital yet. That question is probably better directed to the hospital to keep that on. Relative to thoughts of canceling the pumpkin fest, no. We didn't have that thought. We felt we had a good plan to deal with what would occur. We felt all of the efforts that were made prior to and leading up to it were going to be effective. And I think, unfortunately, we were caught by surprise when things started earlier than we expected. We always plan these events based upon what we experienced last year and make improvements and then try to envision what might we need. And we thought we had it well in hand before that. We fell a little short. But I have to say, all the men and women in uniform from the police and fire and emergency services stepped up wonderfully to help contain the problem until such time we could bring in reinforcements to help. Once reinforcements arrived, I think we contained it extremely well to keep it from blossoming further and then ultimately dissipating it later on in the evening. So no, there was no thought.
Yes, this gentleman right here.
I am Andy Wolf from The Guardian. I'm just wondering that videos of people chanting negative slogans towards the police, I was wondering if these events represent a growing disaffection with certain elements of the youth with law enforcement.
No, I don't know the answer to that. number of students and young people who came up to us and apologized for the behavior of others, I think highly negate that sentiment to a great degree. So that's my sense of it.
Sean, would you like to respond, Rob?
Yeah, I think, I just don't, I want to make sure that we don't understate just how this had the aggressive nature that we saw that night. And I stood, shoulder to shoulder with the town manager and my major and lieutenant, the chief, and to see full cans of beer going over your head, billiard balls, large rocks, large bottles of liquor. There's one thing to form, there's one thing to yell, there's one thing to cheer, there's one thing to commit acts of vandalism to a light post or to a vehicle or to a sign, but to turn your aggression towards another human being in a matter that they did is what I characterize as is extremely serious. And I think it's important for you to know just what happened out there that night.
Thank you. We'll take this gentleman, then we'll take Darrell.
Thank you. Paul Miller from Keene Sentinel. Chief Miola, just jumping off of Martha's question a little bit, you felt that you had this contained. But could you talk a little bit about the level of communication that may have been occurring between your commanders in the campus area and those officers who were protecting Pumpkin Festival? And were there any measures contemplated for the possibility that some element of the party is could have intruded on downtown?
We always planned for that. There's always that thought as we deal with these things because they're so unexpected and so fluid. Uncontrollable to some degree, but we felt like we had a great plan in place. And we discussed this, prior to this ever occurring and how we can manage these types of situations. And not only for this incident, I have to say, it's not just Pumpkin Fest. We planned these things. We've had other weekends where we've had riotous behavior that we've experienced in the past. So we discuss, we train on these things. The incident commanders had control of the people, they had them in the right places, they had the right demeanor and temper to keep the crowd at bay and not antagonize them. So, I think, in my opinion, it played to great success in how our plan worked to contain it and keep it off of Main Street. I never for a second felt threatened that it was going to make it to Main Street or into the footprint. I felt that we did have enough control now.
Daryl Perry, Free Press Publications. On Saturday, there were initial reports of 5 dead. There were also reports of the governor having declared a state of emergency and upwards of 100 Massachusetts state troopers coming to assist. Can you confirm or deny any of those?
What universities are you in contact with right now?
I have
University of New Hampshire, Plymouth State University, and I believe that other colleges and universities in New England have contacted our public safety office, but I don't have that list right in front of me.
Do you know how they're going to handle everything that's been going on?
I know that at the University of New Hampshire, the students will be held accountable. That was a direct conversation I had with the president of UNH this morning.
All right, well, thank you. I believe that that will conclude our press release here this afternoon. I hope you all have your opportunity to get your questions answered. The city manager's office will field additional questions over the course of the next few days. I'll put you in touch with the appropriate party if you need additional information that afternoon.